Hello viewers, welcome to my channel ITJ Olympiads and AP Physics with Ambarish. So today continuing with the theme of elasticity, I'm going to discuss how to find out the torsional constant of a beam. So you must have come across many places where we have a torsional spring, like in moving coil galvanometer. So what's the quality of a torsional spring? That when you twist it through some angle theta, it produces a restoring torque which is proportional to theta. Now, why do we need to discuss this? Because if you see in the Pathfinder, this is a problem, check your understanding properties of matter, where we have a helical spring. So to analyze helical springs, we do need the theory of torsional constants of a beam. So I'm doing the theory on torsional constants of a beam, and later on I'll try to solve the problem from the Pathfinder, that is the problem on the closed coil helical springs. Okay, so now how do we proceed? So let's say this is some kind of a beam. I have shown a cylindrical section beam, but the derivation that I am going to do will be valid not just for cylindrical section beam, but also for, let's say, a square section beam, or maybe a equilateral triangular section beam. But just for simplicity, I had to show something, so I have shown a cylindrical beam as a simple shape. Okay, so this is a cylindrical beam. Imagine that its rear end is welded to a rigid metallic wall, let us say, and on the front end we are trying to twist it by applying some torque. We are giving it some torque. So for how do you apply a torque? So again, imagine that you weld some kind of a disc shaped steering to its front end, and then you are twisting this disc shaped steering so that the front end is getting twisted. Okay, so this is our beam which we are going to twist, and then we are going to look into the physics, what's happening due to the twisting, and then what is the restoring torque that will produce. So if we find the proportionality between the restoring force, restoring torque and theta, we readily will have the torsional constant. Okay, so this is the front view and this is the side view I've shown. Okay, and let us say theta is the small angle of twist. So just to visualize what's going to happen, so imagine that this is made up of so many fibers. So you can imagine this to be made up of grid of fibers, so, and those fibers are going all the way to the front, from front to the back. And just imagine what will happen to those fibers if you twist the front end. All these fibers are going to be twisted a little bit, twisted in the sense that their rear end cannot move. Obviously the rear end of all the filaments that is fixed to the wall, so rear ends cannot move. And the front end, if you have welded a steering, the front end, wherever it is attached to the steering, if the steering point moves, the front end is going to be moving in the same direction. So what will happen? So if you imagine a filament inside, this whole filament is going to be sheared a little bit because its front end is going to move a little from the rear end. So this is what is happening to the fiber. So we are going to consider a cuboidal filament of metal, or fiber of metal, from front face all the way up to the wall. And due to the slight twisting, this filament is going to develop a shear stress and a shear strain that we'll see shortly how the dynamics of it works out. So just for a visual effect, you can see what's happening. So this is, let us say, some cylinder. This is one fiber and going all the way into the page. I've not shown the entire filament, but you can imagine. And then upon twisting, everything, whole thing twists a little bit. So the face that was here, it has shifted to here. Okay, because of the twist, and the rear end is still at the same place. Now I'll try to show the more zoomed out view so that we can analyze the dynamics properly. So just imagine some filament was going inside, and now the front end has moved. So how much will it move? Let us say this filament area is dA, and the distance from the center of the beam is r. So this is r, and let us say the front end of beam is twisted through some angle theta. So that means what? This front end would have moved through an angle r theta. Okay, so that's what I've shown. So this is the rear end of the filament, this is the front end of the filament, and the front end is sheared with respect to the rear end by a distance r theta. I hope you can visualize this. This is r, and so it was, the area was initially here and finally it is here, and you can imagine the depth of it. I hope this figure is very clear, self-explanatory, what's happening to the filament. So and theta is small, just to avoid some complications which will occur with large theta. So imagine theta to be a very small angle. Okay, so this is a highly exaggerated figure. Theta, you can imagine it to be less than a degree or so. Okay, so now If you look at this filament, what is the shear strain? So let us say this angle is gamma. So this vertical length is L and this has shifted through a distance r theta. So that means what? The shear strain is simply going to be tan gamma, which is this is r theta and this vertical dimension is L. So r theta by L is the shear strain in this filament. Okay. And what is the shear stress then? So once you have the shear strain, you can simply multiply it by the shear modulus. So I am using G for shear modulus. Some faculty like to use an eta. So bear that in mind. I hope it will not create any kind of confusion. So sigma S is the shear stress, epsilon S is the shear strain, and G is the shear modulus I am using. So I hope this equation is clear. So just epsilon shear was r theta by L, and then sigma shear simply becomes, you multiply r theta by L by the modulus of rigidity. So that is g r theta over L. So this is your shear stress. Now once I have the shear stress, I know the shearing force acting on it, right? So what is the shearing force? So shear stress is force per unit area. And if this area is dA, so you simply multiply this by dA and you get the shearing force. So once you have the shearing force, you multiply it by the radius, you will get the shearing torque. So let's see step by step. So we had shearing stress and you multiply it by dA. This is the shearing force. And then for shearing torque, we just multiplied it force into perpendicular distance about the axis of the beam. So axis of the beam is going into the this circular section, right through the section like this. The axis of the beam is like this, and we are considering the torque about the axis of the beam. Okay, so this is the twist and this is the torque R multiplied by the shearing force. So elemental shearing force multiplied by R gives you the elemental shearing torque, and that becomes what? So there was already an R here, and you multiply it by another R, so this becomes R square. And there is G theta and L, so this is G theta and L over here, and R square dA. Now when you look at the term R square dA, it should start tickling you, right? I'm sure you are being tickled. Why? Because this is very similar to what we see in moment of inertia. There, instead of dA, we have a dm. So this is some kind of moment of inertia, but instead of moment of inertia, let's call it moment of area. So this is dA, let us say, and this is distance r. So r square dA we'll call as moment of area. The only difference is the instead of mass, we are having an area. So that's what I've written. So tau shearing is g theta by L into integration of r square dA. The term r square dA is very similar to moment of inertia, with dA replacing for dm. Let's call this as polar moment of area. So then our this equation just becomes this equation. Okay, so this becomes I am calling this as IP, that is polar moment of area. So tau is G IP by L into theta. And now you can see readily that the shearing torque acting on the beam is proportional to theta. And since the disc that we pasted on the face, whatever shearing torque it is applying, the same restoring shearing torque will be applied on the disc. And that's why we have now the torsional constant C. Okay, by compare these two equations, so torsional constant is simply G into polar moment of area divided by L. Now calculating polar moment of area is not very difficult. If you know the moment of inertia, you readily know the polar moment of area. You just need to substitute area for the mass. Okay, so torsional constant is G IP by L, as I proved there. So this is, and for example, if you have a solid circular cylinder, okay, so you have a solid circular cylinder, then this is your area. Your area is pi r square. Okay, so polar moment of area, you know that moment of inertia of a disc is half mr square, so it will be half ar square. So that's what I've written, half ar square, and area is this area, so that is pi r square. So it becomes pi r to the power 4 divided by 2. So what happens to the torsional constant? So g ip by l, so g by l comes as it is, g by l comes as it is, and then pi r to the power 4 divided by 2. So this is the torsional constant. Okay, now once we have the torsional constant, we can do several problems. We can use this for simple harmonic motion. So I'm sure you have done SHM problems with the torsional springs, and you know that time period of a torsional pendulum is 2 pi under root I by C, where I is the moment of inertia and C is the torsional constant. Okay, so that's the time period of a torsional pendulum. And similarly, if you want to find out through what will be the angular deflection in a beam if you apply a torque on the front face, so you know that tau is simply equal to C theta. So you can readily calculate theta once you have the torsional constant. So you can use the same formula, whether it's a square section beam, rectangular section beam, equilateral triangular section beam, or whatever kind of beam. Okay, so this is your torsional constant. Okay, and I hope you enjoyed this video and you liked the concept involved here. And if you did like this video, please do share it with your friends, whatever study groups you might be part of, in the Telegram groups or WhatsApp groups, or whatever study groups you are part of, please do share my video. Please do give it a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel if you have not already subscribed. Thanks a lot for watching this video, and please do keep coming back. I'll try to put in best of my hard work to bring in more conceptual problems for you.